Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome this opportunity of addressing a few remarks to you and at the end of asking you to deal with me as you may think fit, but I would mention that when you do come to the questions, I will do my best and we've got nothing to hide. But if I can't answer them, it is because certain details have still got to be decided, and matters, particularly one or two which I will mention later, cannot yet be discussed, and the other possibility is the fact that I may not know the answer, and I will tell you so if I don't. Now, I think there has been possibly some slight misunderstanding as regards the setup as we have these committees. Now, when a coronation is first planned, the sovereign, that is the Queen, appoints a coronation commission. And as you know, there is one now, of which His Royal Highness the Duke of Edinburgh is chairman. That embodies the various member countries of the Commonwealth, as well as this country. Now, there is alongside that the Privy Council Committee, presided over by the Lord President of the Council, and that is a United Kingdom Privy Council. By 8:30 that morning, the doors of the Abbey will be closed, and therefore all the guests must be there by that time. At the same hour, the street lining of the route to the Abbey will have been completed, and we shall be ready to receive the first of the many processions. There are 9 of these, and I don't propose to give you the details. I think you have got them in front of you. They start, as you know, with the Lord Mayor, and then they end at 11 o'clock with the procession of Her Majesty. And accompanied by the Duke of Edinburgh, who will be wearing the full dress of an Admiral of the Fleet, arrive at the royal entrance to the annex. And it's my privilege and honor to receive them at that point. And inside the door will be the great officers of state and others who take part in this procession. I think it will be when the procession itself starts to move up the nave of the church and the choir sing that anthem, and there's a fanfare of trumpets as the Queen comes through the west door of the Abbey, and when she arrives at the choir, the Queen's scholars of Westminster School, in the customary manner, yell, "Vivat, Vivat, Regina Elizabetha." And that really, you can say, is the beginning of the service. And so far as we estimated at the moment, it will be 2.5 hours from the time that the procession moves up the nave to the recess when we go back and the Queen arrives back at the annex at, shall we say, 1:30 to 1:45. The crowning, which of course is the climax the moment for which all this work has been carried out through the month should be at approximately 12:30. And at that moment, there will be the firing of the salute outside, the trumpets blowing in the abbey, and the whole of the congregation will be yelling, "God save the Queen." And that is the most tremendous and moving moment, possibly, of the whole of the day.
Scotland
comes to its end, and the recess has taken place. The procession within the abbey is back in the annex, and the Queen will go to this room which has been made for, and she will have a rest and a lunch after what I think you will all agree will have been a reasonable ordeal and strain for anyone for that period. Now, because of the broadcast, which is going to be relayed of the whole ceremony within the abbey, we don't want any troops or procession moving within the streets during that period. And so it has been arranged that so soon as the procession with the Queen arrives back in the annex, then the head of the procession, that's the from procession, the great coronation procession through the streets, will move off from Storey's Gate, where it will have been formed up using Birdcage Walk and Wellington Barracks and places down there. And that procession will move through the route until the head reaches somewhere near Stannard Gate, which is where it will be at the time that the coach with the Queen leaves the west door of Westminster Abbey. That evening, there will be the flypast of the RAF, in which will be witnessed by the Queen from the balcony. Now, there will be something like 15,000 troops lining the route, and there will be some 10,000, I understand, in the procession, and of which 2,500 will be from the Commonwealth and colonies, making a total of some 31,000 troops when you take in consideration the 46 bands. I tell you of the very great personal interest that the Queen takes in this coronation. And it is remarkable with the amount of other matters that she has to consider, how she always finds time not only to see me, but to deal with any matters that she is asked. And it is a great honor to serve such a person. And I assure you that so far as I am concerned, it makes the responsibility greater, because one realizes how important it is to make this the success which not only you, but also she deserves. And finally, if I may, I would say one word to the press and to the newsreels. And that is to thank you, particularly this morning, for the patience with which you listened to me, and the support that in general you have given. I'm not going to say there haven't been one or two exceptions. I suppose we've all got the right to say what we like when we like, but there's also, I think, a responsibility to say it at the right time. But by and large, ladies and gentlemen, I would say thank you. I would assure you that what help we can give, given the time, we will give it. But as I said to Mr. Hoare, who I may tell you has been a tremendous standby to me in the last few weeks, as I said to him when he first came and we set up the press bureau, the coronation office, or the Earl Marshal's coronation office, is not a place from which hot stories come day after day. And finally, a very great strain for our Queen. Join with me and help her all you can.